HashMap Megabytes.
Hello, and welcome to another episode of HashMap Megabytes. Today, we are going to discuss the Snowflake web UI and how to navigate that space. First thing, go ahead and open your Snowflake account, your URL. You'll notice there, you'll have a URL that ends in snowflakecomputing.com, but this first part before that is what identifies your account. So today I'm going to be working on GCP and a partner account that we don't really use. So it's not been set up. It should be totally fresh. Enter your credentials and log in. And you're likely going to notice if this is a trial account and this is your first time logging in, that you'll be greeted with some sort of pop-up welcoming you. You can close that. And then up top, you'll see probably sysadmin if this is your first time in a trial account. That's your default. We're going to go ahead, before we do anything else, just to make sure we can see everything in the UI, click on this, go to switch role, and then click on account admin. That's the highest level role, and it's going to let us explore all parts of the UI today. Great. So once this is logged back in, we can work our way through. You start out on the worksheets page, and that's for a good reason. That's where most of your work will happen. It's where we'll write SQL. And as you add additional projects, you can add things here and name them. And this is mostly how you'll organize kind of ad hoc SQL querying. We'll get back to worksheets, but for now, let's go over to databases. Databases are the top level storage object. And if you want to explore any sort of table or view or schema, you're going to find all of that in the databases tab. So first look, we're going to see that we have a number of different database areas here. And a database that I know everyone has is the Snowflake database. This is the database Snowflake uses to expose your own usage back to your account as views. So tables, we shouldn't see anything here, but we could create tables through the UI. We could explore existing tables. Click on views, and we'll see all these different views that already exist. And these are really interesting. Query history is going to tell you everything that's been run on your instance, and you can do some analytics off of that. But moving on, we also have schemas. And schemas are like folders within databases. That's all they are. They're naming functionality so that you can separate different things based on the name of project that you're in. But you can also do schema-level permissions, and that can make things pretty convenient. Moving on, we have stages, which are pointers really to external data in a cloud file storage service. File formats are stored named rules for how to read a file format. So if you have a CSV, but it's actually separated by like the pipe character, you can create a special file format here that has those instructions. And then sequences. These are a SQL feature that, you know, some of you may use. It's a little more advanced. We're not going to discuss them here, but you'll see some of that information in this area. Moving on, the next tab is the shares, and these are areas that Snowflake allows you to share data either externally or to receive shared data to you. So you should see set up inbound shares from account usage, and this is exactly what Snowflake uses to share your information back to you. It's an actual formal share. And some of you probably have sample data as well that's being shared. You can see your outbound as well. You maybe have some of these set up right now. We don't have any set up, but if I were some sort of a data vendor, I sold advertising data or housing data or anything, this would be a really great way for me to expose the data I'm already computing in Snowflake to my end clients without having to copy and while maintaining really secure controls over who's seeing what. Moving on, we have warehouses. And warehouses it's an interesting tab. I think most people new to Snowflake, they follow pretty normally through databases and through shares. Because shares, they mean what they say, that's how you share data. And databases are just storage. You have database folders, and inside those you have schema kind of folders, and then you have tables and views, the things that we're mostly used to. But warehouses are a little different. They're confusing because Snowflake itself is a warehouse. And now within this cloud data warehouse, we have these other warehouses. So a couple things to know. First, these warehouses are just virtual compute units. They're just clusters of computers that are gonna run your queries. They do not store data. That's the big misconception I see a lot of people think, that we're storing data in these warehouses. We're not. Data only lives on this database layer. That's where all of our information, all of our rows are. So if I want to run a query that requires computing on data, maybe just grab the top 10 rows of a table, I'm going to need a combination of data to read from, and then a compute unit to actually load the data into these clusters, grab the top 10 and report that back to me. So when we say that Snowflake separates storage and compute, that's what we're talking about. And this allows me to have any number of warehouses that I want with a good descriptive name, and those have sizes. Those can scale up pretty dramatically in size, but they can scale back down too. So they're ephemeral, they come up, they come down, you delete them. They don't run if you don't want them to, so they don't bill. There's no cost just to have a warehouse. So these are good things to know about, and the more you use them, the more natural it'll become thinking this way. Next is the worksheet section, which we were on before. Again, this is where we write our SQL, and we can also explore kind of our tables and views in this area. So if I click on this Snowflake database that we looked at before, and I go into account usage, we can see all these views are here, and then query them as we need to. Moving on, we have the history tab, which is something that's pretty interesting. You may see this in different systems, but this is where we would go if we want to explore who ran what query when. And if we want to debug a specific query, maybe if something's failed or if it's running slowly. Each one of these queries are gonna have a specific query ID that links you to a unique description and overview of that query, a summary of who ran it, some start and end time information, what was actually ran. And depending on the query, you get this query profile. And this is interesting to dive into for much larger, more complex queries. You can identify where your bottlenecks are or where you should start applying optimizations. So this is good to know about. We go back to history and we're here. You can filter this as well. Moving on, we have the account tab. So important to note, if you're not the account admin, you likely don't see this. If you log in as sysadmin or a much lower privilege, you don't see this tab. So this is only for higher level roles. I think out of the box, only account admin and security admin can even see this tab. So here we see our usage. As you can see, we've only been charged for cloud services. No compute has run. If I look at my storage, which is another tab here, we have not even 10 kilobytes. I mean, it's just so small. So we're doing nothing on here, really. And then data transfer would be here as well. So if you're worried about what you're spending, you want to look at that. This is a great space to go into. Next, we have our users area. And this is where I could create a user. I could delete a user or alter a user in here. And this is a great way to manage your users. Next are roles. So in Snowflake, permissions are role-based. And to be able to leverage anything, every user must have access to a role that does hold permissions. So right now, I'm using the account admin role. We all are. And I can see which people have access to this. And I can see what other out-of-the-box roles are here. These are the ones that Snowflake creates for you by default, and then you can create your own and build your own security hierarchy. Next step are policies, and these are really network policies. So if you wanted to ensure that only network from inside your VPN, your corporate VPN, were able to access Snowflake, you could create that rule here and then modify those rules as well. One thing to note, I've seen people do this. If you're at your home network and you're just firing this up, you want to be super secure, don't just Google your IP and then whitelist this, because you're very likely to lock yourself out. Home IPs are not typically static. So make sure you're using a VPN, or otherwise you know exactly what your IP will always be before you do this. And another tip, make sure you have more than one, because it can take a little while to get back into here if you lock yourself out. Next is sessions. So we can see not just individual users, but what specific concurrent sessions they might have in here, and get some start end time information about that and their specific drivers. So right now it's all web UI for me. Next are our resource monitors. And that name maybe doesn't mean much. This is really budgeting. This is where you go in and set a hard limit for how many credits I will allow to be spent, both at the account level and at the individual warehouse level. So this is a really good space to go into maybe on day one and set some reasonable limits. That way you don't accidentally leave something on and charge yourself too much. And then last is the reader account section. This is an interesting space that is complementary to some of the sharing features that allows you to create kind of a separate account. It will have a whole new URL that has access to certain resources in your space. You will pay for that space so that any reading or compute that gets charged there does go up to you, but then you can give that account space to a partner, another client, some other person that you wouldn't normally want to have access to your actual environment, but you do want to share data to. And these are mostly useful for people that you're doing sharing with that don't have Snowflake today. If they do have Snowflake, I'd encourage you to look at a share. So this is the major components of the UI. In the top right, we see a couple other things. Partner Connect's useful if you want to start using some of the other great tools in the ecosystem. Really, all of these are really good tools. I use a lot of them daily. Help section, which we're so often used to just ignoring because it doesn't help, but here it really, really does help. Downloads, this is a great place to get started with some of the drivers and the CLI, which is itself really, really useful. And then we can get into the documentation, which is one of the best features of Snowflake. Notifications are here, but if you haven't set those up, you probably don't have anything. And then lastly, we can change a couple preferences about our user, change our password, and then switch our role for the whole UI. So if I switch back to a lower level here, security admin, you'll notice that we don't have access to the account area. We can't see that. And typically, you can't see this at all. I'm willing to bet if I refresh my screen, account it disappears entirely. Oh, I'm sorry, I'm security admin. So security admin can see users, can see roles, but if I switch to sysadmin, yeah, okay, so account's gone entirely here. So this is the main overview of the Snowflake UI. It's pretty intuitive once you get the lay of the land, you learn some of the terminology. Thanks for watching and stay tuned for more HashMap Megabytes.
HashMap Megabytes.